The first verse from the Old Testament is from Exodus chapter 34, verses 29 through 35. When Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tables of the testimony in his hand, as he came down from the mountains, Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone, because he had been talking with God. But when Aaron and all the people of Israel saw Moses, behold, the skin of his face shone, and they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called to them, and Aaron and all the leaders of the congregation returned to him, and Moses talked with them. And afterward, all the people of Israel came near, and he gave them in commandment all that the Lord had spoken with him in Mount Sinai. And when Moses had finished speaking with them, he put a veil on his face. But whenever Moses went in before the Lord to speak with him, he took the veil off until he came out. And when he came out, he told the people of Israel what was he commanded. And the people of Israel saw the face of Moses, that the skin of Moses' face shone. And Moses would put the veil upon his face again until he went in to speak with him. The epistle lesson is from 2 Corinthians chapter 3, starting with verse 12, continuing on into chapter 4, the second verse. Since we have such a hope, we are very bold, not like Moses, who put a veil over his face so that the Israelites might not see the end of the fading splendor, but their minds were hardened. For to this day, when they read the old covenant, that same veil remains unlifted, because only through Christ is it taken away. Yes, to this day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their minds. But when a man turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we all, with unveiled face, holding the glory of the Lord, are being changed into his likeness from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Therefore, having this ministry by the mercy of God, we do not lose heart. We have renounced disgraceful, underhanded ways. We refuse to practice cunning or to tamper with God's word. But by the open statement of the truth, we would commend ourselves to every man's conscience in the light of God. And the gospel reading is from Luke chapter 9, starting with verse 28, going to number 36. Now about 8 days after these sayings, he took with him Peter and John and James, and went up to the mountain to pray. And as he was praying, the appearance of his countenance was altered, and his raiment became dazzling white. And behold, two men talked with him, Moses and Elijah, who appeared in glory and spoke of his departure, which he was to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and those who were with him were heavy with sleep, but kept awake, and they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. And as the men were parting from him, Peter said to Jesus, Master, it is well that we are here. Let us make three booths, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah, not knowing what he had said. And as he said this, a cloud came over, shadowed them, and they were afraid as they entered the cloud. And a voice came out of the cloud saying, This is my son, my chosen. Listen to him. And when the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone, and they kept silence and told no one in those days anything of what they had seen.
Well, grace to you and peace from God our Heavenly Father and His Son Jesus Christ, our blessed Lord. You know the story of Transfiguration. You've heard it many, many times, year in and year out. It is a story that appears in all the Gospels, basically. But in this particular gospel, There are some variations. The traditional understanding was apparent in some of the liturgy and responses that I've already made as I led worship with you today. There is this understanding that Jesus Christ, engaged in his ministry, is transfigured, and suddenly there appears with him Moses and Elijah. Moses comes and has a conversation with him. Moses is the one who received the law. And so in this conversation, there is a caucus, not Iowa style, but a caucus nonetheless, in which Moses discusses the subtleties and the nuances of the law which he brought with Jesus Christ, who is the King of Kings. Elijah comes, the great prophet of Israel, the eschatological prophet, the final prophet, the one that you expect when Messiah comes. And together they consult with each other and talk about all the splendid and wonderful prophecies of the Old Testament. And Elijah comes to do so with the King of Kings, Jesus Christ. And God opens up the heavens, comes out of the cloud, and says, "This is my son. This is my child." He's endorsed yet again in this mysterious and miraculous manner. But in this particular gospel, there are three things that are a little different from the accounts in the other gospels that I want to call to your attention. In this gospel, I think there is within the meta message a subtle and minor message. Kind of like a little theme when an orchestra is playing and there's that one instrument that's kind of off doing its own thing and starting to bring something else into it. The difference in this gospel account begins with the occasion that is cited, that this is the eighth day. And if you do the math and look at what day this was, it would be saying that this is the Sunday after. It would be saying the eighth day is a Sunday. It would be saying in the Christian context that this is something that's occurring on the resurrection day. For every time we worship on a Sunday, we celebrate a mini Easter. We gather on this day of the week to remember Jesus Christ, not in his ministry, not in his death, but in his resurrection power. We remember that he arose. He died, but he did not stay dead. This gospel is making the point as it tells the story. Remember the day that this is occurring. It is Resurrection Day on which transfiguration occurs. There is a second motif here on this day that will eventually become the Resurrection Day. Jesus begins his encounter with this holy, and he does so in prayer. Throughout this gospel, you constantly see Jesus in prayer. You understand the depth of the spirituality of Jesus, that even though he was Jesus Christ, he required to be a person of prayer, connecting in intimacy with the Father, talking and praying, reflecting, listening to the Spirit in harmony as Trinity. Jesus prays in this depiction of the Transfiguration. And then this Transfiguration happens in the context of that which will become the Resurrection Day, in the context of Jesus Christ deep in prayer. In that context, in that situation, that setting, transfiguration comes, Moses comes, Elijah comes, the Father comes, and there is this radiance, this splendor that comes from being so intimately in the presence of God. And the third one, suddenly and inexplicably in the account, we're told about the disciples who were there. And what we're told is that they were heavy with sleep. The disciples are always heavy with sleep. I mean, you might think they're my age. I have dinner, I sit in my chair, off I go. Heavy with sleep, heavy with sleep. But the thing here is, in this gospel, sleep is also a euphemism. When Lazarus dies, Jesus said, our friend has fallen asleep. There is this kind of reference to death as sleep. In our society, you'll hear somebody say, well, so-and-so passed, or they passed away. I had a colleague once that absolutely despised that phrase. And people would come up in the South and say, now, Pastor, so-and-so passed. And he would say, they're dead! It was a big one, subtlety, this stuff. But in this gospel, that concept of death as sleep is subtly interwoven. So when you see things talking about sleep, this gospel is also talking about death. So in addition to the traditional understanding of Moses the lawgiver and Elijah the prophet meeting with Jesus in the presence of the Father and receiving that endorsement yet again, what else is being said here? What is being said as Jesus engages in his ministry? What's being said as ultimately we begin Lent this week and head to the cross? We're being reminded that there is this place called heaven. We're being reminded that even though we walk through the valley of shadow, we come through that valley into the light of God. We are reminded that while we might yet sleep, we will one day sleep no more, but be in eternity in the presence of God. And we are reminded that that occurs on the eighth day, because Jesus Christ arose and was resurrected. Transfiguration in all its radiance and in all its glory, all its splendor, reminds us that someday that joy will be ours, and we'll be able to talk to the Apostle Paul and engage in conversation about why we didn't like some of the things he said. Or Moses, or Elijah, but best of all, we will sit at Jesus' feet. And even now, we get our glimpse of heaven. We get it just like Jesus did. When we bow our heads, when we pray, when we feel the Holy Spirit, and when we talk to the Father. Oh yes, there is a reason Transfiguration comes this Sunday before we begin that Lenten odyssey of morbid and ancient hymns. It reminds us that there is heaven. And those whom we love who have gone before, we will see them again.